tea. Okay, this bag over here contains 9 grams, but today we're gonna just use 5 grams. So I'm gonna dump into this little container here. And then, may I have some water, please? Thank you. And first, before I put the tea leaves in, remember we all have to warm up our teapot. Okay, here we go. Thank you. Don't think that I can do this by myself. I actually have a group of teams. They are busy, busier than me. Okay, now I'm gonna put some water in this pot and a few of this pot. You're probably wondering how come I need 3 pots, right? Okay, I'll tell you why in a moment. Okay, here we go. I'm gonna close the lid of this pot. How do we know when our pot is warmed up? Now, when you can feel some warmth on your tea, your pot lid, then it's ready. Okay, today I wanna brew 2 more kinds of teas. So I wanna compare a little bit to the different types of oolong tea. One is the one that we're using. Of course, we're gonna use 5 grams, and I wanna set the environment for the tea leaves exactly the same environment for them to brew. And then we can compare how the taste and how the color. And if you are ready to have a pen and then your tea tasting journal on your side, then when you are ready to write down your thoughts and your observation, then you can write down on your tea tasting journal. So now, I can feel the warmth on the lid. So I'm ready to dump my water out. And I'm gonna use this one to warm up some other vessels that will hold my tea liquors later, so they don't change too much of the flavor of the tea I'll be making. Okay, now 2 teapots is ready. And this one, we're gonna dump them. All right. So here we go, I see teapots. You're curious which one I'm gonna use, right? First of all, this teapot over here, exactly 300 ml. So I'm gonna use this as a guide and pour some hot water into my first pot, which is this beautiful, beautiful Japanese made teapot. And I'm gonna put about 5 grams of teas into my pot. That's about right. Then we will use exactly 300 ml, whoops, hot water to this teapot, a warmed teapot. Great. Then here, I'm going to set my timer for 3 minutes. All right, now close the lid. Now the second teapot I'm gonna put in is the very familiar Alishan High Mountain Oolong Tea. The oolong tea we have today is roasted and it's not from High Mountain. However, don't think that only High Mountain has the best quality. So we are gonna have a little comparison today. I'm gonna dump exactly the 5 grams into this teapot. And I'm gonna use the same amount of hot water. Why do I do that? I pop the teapot open all the time. Okay, here we go. Now. Perfect. Okay, extra, a little bit extra water. Now here, this is your favorite part. I wonder if you can see, this is organic oolong tea bag. So I want to show you, I'm going to show you this is what you normally do. Now those are the tea bags. And because each one only contains about roughly 2 grams, so I'm going to dump 2 tea bags into my third brewing vessel. Remember, there are oolong tea as well, and organic too. Okay, let's fill this up. Looks nice. We'll see what's happening. After 3 minutes. Now we got three teas going on here. And I'd like you to take a look, see the water temperature. After you boil, you could let it sit for about 30 seconds to a minute. Okay, you don't have to use boiling water right away for oolong tea. Because oolong tea is actually not like a dark tea or fully oxidized the black teas. See, they don't really need a hot bath. If you can let it sit just a little bit, and the tea will go, oh, that's a perfect temperature. I can live with it. And for 3 minutes, it's long enough to allow the tea leaves to open, and then we can enjoy the beautiful, the delicious, and then the unbelievable aroma all these teas have brought to us. But you're gonna ask, and I say, what is Gongfu style and what is Western style? I think basically the difference is that the Gongfu style, you will use a lot more tea, but you brew a lot shorter. Let's think this way. To me, Gongfu style brewing is like an orchestra, a string ensemble is playing the music. So you have a lot more musicians. And of course, when they play, it's very strong. But with Western style, time's up. It's like you're listening to the music played by a string quartet. It's still nice. You still have the nice music, but it's a lot mellower. The taste is a lot sweeter because you are not getting so much of the tea. And sometimes the tea, they just have this astringency that some people don't like, but that personally, I love astringency from the tea. And sometimes it lifts it into your tea. Okay, so now after you brew, when the time is up, I don't want you to let the tea leaves sit in your teapot. You have to get them out. Otherwise, they continue to brew. And it's like when you cook and you overcook some dishes, or especially when you overcook your vegetables, don't they taste a little old? They do taste a little old, right? So now we're ready to strain our first pot of tea. Right here, straining out. Has very nice little pale golden yellow. I hope you can see it. Can you see it? Wow. Beautiful. I hope you're brewing the tea with me right now. Now, let's see. Unbelievable smell. Wow, I want you to also observe the color, okay? But you don't have to completely agree with me. Drinking tea is very subjective. You know, some people like this, and some people don't like that, and some people just prefer this. And you can never say, well, the teacher says the tea tastes like peach. And I have to say it tastes like peach. But to you, maybe it tastes like plum. And that's totally okay. Now that's drain our second pot of tea, which is Alisha High Mountain Oolong tea. I don't think I can hold the whole thing over here for 300 ml. Okay, very nice. Wow, later I want you to see the difference of the color. Can you please take my teapot away? Thank you. Yes, thank you. All right, now we're ready for, can you see the color? This one is the tea today. It's in that beautiful golden orangey because it was roasted. And this one is High Mountain tea, it's not roasted. See the difference of in color? Very well. Now here is our tea bag. Remember, this is a very high quality tea bag. Okay. But I would like to taste it, and then we'll taste the difference of in taste. Okay, let's smell it. Now this is our tea. I want you to look at your tea tasting journal over here. Now let's see, the dry leaf and shape and color. they are kind of like a half bowl shape, isn't it? So I want you to write it down. And the fragrance, dry tea leaves cannot be smelled unless you have some kind of heat into it. So you will actually put, while you warm up your teapot, you can put your dry tea leaves in there, then you can kind of smell it. You open the lid, you will smell it. Then you will write your thoughts on it. Now let's look at the tea liquor color. I would say it's kind of a golden yellow, right? Golden yellow, and it's very, very clean, very clear. So it's very top quality tea. Then the fragrance, let's smell it. What does it smell like? I think it smells like a little bit like a forest, and smell a little bit of the ripened plum to me. And also a little bit like a green apple. I hope you do enjoy that. And now we're gonna have a taste of it, and then we'll go on to our next section. Let me pour myself some tea. First of all, I'm gonna taste our tea. Well, cheers, everybody. Let's have a sip. Well, this way, you brew a tea that is not astringent. It's actually kind of sweet because it's organic tea. Has a little sweet taste to it. Let's see. Feels like I have put a little bit of sugar in it. Very nice. Okay, let's go on. Do you know where tea was from? Well, let's go on to the next section. Can we have the PPT, please? Okay, go on. Now your tasting journal, that's your homework this week. So if you have any questions, you're welcome to type into our chat room and I will get back to you and answer your question as soon as our class is over. And of course it takes time, I cannot do right away, but you're welcome to give us some feedback and we're looking forward to hear from you. Now let's go on to see where is the birthplace of tea. You probably don't know how to pronounce the words Yunnan province, but it's in China. And this was told that I can find it. Those tea trees are 1,000 years old. They're very, very old. So if you think the tea can only grow up to the bush size, then actually no, they can grow into big trees, 20, 30 feet. And they can live for a long time. And that's where the oldest tea trees are still existing in the world in Yunnan province. And there was a myth that say, how did tea come from? Who discovered tea? Of course, the famous myth is that we have this Emperor Shennong, that one day he went out with his followers and they were tired. Of course, they rested under a tree. And you know, from long time ago, Chinese already know how to boil water to drink. While the water is boiled, and all of a sudden some leaves just follow along the wind and then drop into the bowl. And emperor tasted it and said, wow, this liquid is very refreshing. So that's, they say, how the tea was discovered. And at the beginning, Chinese used it as a medicine because it's so refreshing and it can inspire you and then keep you alert. So we use it as a medicine. But later on, people really enjoy it, and then we'll talk about it later. But another myth, this is the one that just, I want you to just enjoy it as a folklore, okay? The founder of Zen Buddhism from Tang Dynasty, that he's always a very diligent spiritual cultivator, practitioner. But one day he fell asleep for 9 years while he was meditating. And when he woke up, he feels so ashamed of himself. And he said, I will never do this again. So he cut off his eyelid. Those eyelids fell off on the ground and grew into tea bushes. Well, this is just a nice story to listen to, but I don't know if the eyelid can grow into tea bushes, so please do not try at home. Okay, let's go on. Since we already had tea, but who drinks tea? Well, that's it. I want to take you to Asia, as you know. In your mind, you probably think all Asians drink tea. So let's explore some countries are known for their fats known for some kind of tea ritual. And we're just going to briefly to walk over to these countries, and then we explore a little bit. But I hope you enjoy the class. And in the future, I will talk about each individual country in more details. So let's go to China first. 5,000 years of tea drinking. That's a long time. Well, see, earlier I said that we found the Emperor Shennong, actually it was 2737 BC, that he already discovered tea. And now it's 2020? So yeah, it's almost 5,000 years of drinking tea. But Chinese did not really drinking tea just the way you look, we drink tea now. It's actually for a long, long time, they actually compressed the tea leaves and make a tea brick. And when you are ready to drink, then we'll grind that tea brick into powder. Then you whisk it. You say, wait a minute, isn't that Japanese tea ceremony? But I have to tell you that Japanese took that from Chinese. That's when the Tang Dynasty, one of the Buddhist monks came to China to study. And when he went back to Japan, he also brought the seeds back to Japan. He discovered that this beverage can help you to stay alert, to stay awake at the same time, but also calm yourself. So he thought that's the perfect beverage for the monks. Okay, so that was the story. That was using those bricks that we had to grind them. But how did it happen that later Chinese have this tiny little pots and we are drinking using us steeping those teas? That happened in Ming Dynasty, which is the three dynasty after Tang Dynasty. The Emperor Hongwu, who is the founder of a Ming Dynasty, thought that that's just too much trouble. You know, why don't we just get the tea leaves and process the way that we like it, and then we brew it. Why go through so much trouble using a bowl and cook the tea and this like that? So he banned tea brick. He said, no more tea bricks in this country. You cannot make it. If you think that this is a democracy, you should not say that, but if you know the Chinese history that we all enjoyed have an emperor. So emperor says, go this way, you do not go the other way. So since then, we don't have any tea breaks. But remember why we still enjoy this Tang style tea ceremony? We really have to thank the Japanese. Okay, they are able to preserve our past, and we're really grateful. So anyway, let's move on. That we now sleep tea, because we use tea leaves, and we don't really require a big pot to cook the tea. So Chinese start to develop using this purple clay to make a tiny little teapot. So you probably know about Yixing teapots. They're very, very high quality. Those are the teapots that develop. And so many people start to make teapots, and they start to make a teaware, and the porcelain, all these industries start to flourish. So that's a good thing, isn't it? Okay, let's move on to the next country or region. Can we go back to, we have not finished with that. Thank you. Hong Kong, what is very important is they have a tradition that in the morning, the people get together drinking tea and eat snacks. So next week, we will get to explore to make one of the tea snacks, and it's called Yam Cha. In Hong Kong, it's also one type of drink is very famous, is they took very strong black tea and add evaporated milk to it. That's called Hong Kong style milk tea. And you can add sugar and you don't have to. It's just very flavorful. Now, I just talk about Japan. You know about green tea, Japanese green tea, and then the Japanese tea ceremony. Basically, they preserve the old traditional Chinese tea ceremony. And if you like to see how old Chinese drink tea, we go to Japan. And the green tea in Japan, we all know, they made gyokuro, they make a shancha. This type of green tea is very different than that type of green teas in China. Because when you pick the tea leaves, And instead of pan fry it, which is widely used in China, then they steam the tea leaves to stop being oxidized. We call it kale green. And this is the two types of green tea. They all taste very delicious, but it just have a different flavor to it. Then why do I have to mention Korea? Let's keep going. They also make Korea also is a big green tea distributor. They grow green tea, but their green tea is so delicate. And the most famous green tea from Korea is called sparrow's tongues. And they're just these little tiny, tiny little buds that is just so unique. And the taste is so refreshing and sweet. And I want to mention the difference of the tea ceremony in Korea and Japan. Japanese tea ceremony is a lot formal and have a lot of restrictions. So you really have to reserve yourself. But Korean said, we have a tea ceremony, but we like to make it more relaxed. So that way it's a lot more relaxed and friends join together. You don't have this, you know, you can only this. It's a lot more of a relaxing atmosphere. So in Korea. Now Taiwan, it's the home of high mountain oolong tea right here that I brew for you. And I'm sure some of you already have that at home. I would like you to try it and compare with the tea today, see the color and taste. In Taiwan, there's also another famous tea that nowadays very, very popular among young people. It's called bubble tea. It's not because the tea has a bubble itself, but because you keep shaking it, make a lot of bubbles. Inside, you also have tapioca balls that are made like a little snack type. And of course, it's sweet. And you can also make it into different flavors. Okay, let's go on to the next PPT. Thank you. And I want to go on to other countries that you probably know very well. Do you like an English breakfast? You do, right? Okay. Those are the teas that mainly from India. Okay. India is the largest black tea production country. Actually, I have to take that back. I'm not sure if Kenya in Africa has become the largest exporter. I will do a research for you. But in India, there are three different regions growing very different types of tea. In Darjeeling, which is on the higher altitude, that the tea has a very unique sour grape taste we call mesquite. It just tastes, that's why it's called, the Darjeeling tea is called the champagne of teas. It's such a unique flavor. I personally really like the first flush. And if you can try that, find the Darjeeling first flush tea, you will be amazed to say, wow, it tastes so light. However, it's a black tea. And the next region is Assam. And we're very familiar with it because Assam tea is widely used in all this black tea that you add milk to it. If you add milk and sugar to it, it tastes just fantastic. And the other one is going to Jilly. You probably last know, but the flavor is very intense. Still, it's still black tea. And what you think about Indian is probably masala chai. C-H-A-I is just another way of saying tea. So you don't want to say chai tea because it sounds silly. It sounds, you're talking about tea. Okay. So if you want to say just masala chai, and what's in masala is the black tea. Then you mix them, you will add ginger, cardamom, black pepper, and some cinnamon to it. And that will cook, and then you add milk to it. It's a very, very, I mean, I personally love it when I yearn for milk tea. Masala chai is always my choice. Now, I'm gonna also introduce the next country, it's called Nepal. It's very close to Darjeeling where they grow the teas. So the tea bushes and the types are very similar. But because Nepal is a country that does not near any ports, so if they want to export their teas, they have to go through India. And that can cause some kind of trouble. But what I like about the Nepal tea is that they limited the usage of a pesticide. So Nepali tea always tastes the very...
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Next one is Pakistan and Sri Lanka. These two countries are because they are heavily influenced by British culture. So you will see them drink a lot of tea that with milk and sugar. And Sri Lanka, maybe you think they grow coffee beans, but nowadays they're also a big exporter of teas, black teas too. Okay, let's go on to the next slide. All right, now I'm gonna quickly go through all these countries. These countries are basically in Southern Asia. Indonesia has becoming bigger and bigger in growing teas. So they are actually a large exporter of teas as well. Malaysians drink tea that because they have the custom, they also drink tea from the influence of Britain, Great Britain. And Myanmar, I want to bring out this word called leopard. And that's the only country in the world that actually eat tea leaves instead of brewing it. They actually may marinate and make a pickle tea leaves to eat like a dish. I personally have not tried it yet, but maybe somebody you have tried it, please let me know. Send me a jar that I will appreciate, and then we'll talk about the flavor. And then Thailand has this tea that you see, it's kind of orange kind of type, the color. It's not because the tea itself is orange, it's because they have food coloring. So maybe you want to be careful with that. You can enjoy it. It's very sweet because it was sweetened by condensed milk. And of course, when I was younger, I love it. And Tibet, they churn the tea with yak milk. So kind of churn into it and then the butter came out. So in this tea, it's very unique. It's very strong tea with the yak milk and butter, okay? Then go to Vietnam. Vietnam has become one of the largest tea exporter as well, just the recent decades, because the demand of tea leaves, and then they have a lot of Taiwanese methods, skills to produce tea. So you see a lot of Oolong teas come from Vietnam. The quality is not bad at all, of course, but I will have to say that Taiwan still has the best skill in making Oolong tea. Let's look at the picture on the PPT that's called lotus tea, that in the middle of the night, the lotus flower open, and then the tea farmers will put the tea leaves inside the lotus and then force the lotus to close it for overnight. Then the next day they will harvest all the lotus leaf back to the tea farm and open the lotus leaf. So the tea leaves actually observe the smell and of this sweetness of lotus. So when you brew your teas, you actually naturally have lotus flower, you know, aroma. Isn't that amazing? Okay, let's go on to the next section. Okay, the next two countries I want to talk about is Iran and Turkey. And well, when you're in Iran, before you're drinking a cup of tea, that you put a rock candy in your mouth, and you kind of just drink it through. So that can, I have never tried that. Maybe you can tell me. And Turkey, it's also one of the largest tea consuming countries because they just love tea so much. But when they drink tea, they use a thing just very similar to Russia. It's called samovar, but they don't use that. It's kind of like the same thing. You actually brew the tea, but you have hot water, use the little samovar, and you can dilute the tea. So it's very similar to a way of a Russian to drink their tea for these two countries. Okay, let's go on. Am I talking too fast? But I think I just drink a lot of tea. That's why I am kind of going really fast. Okay, now in Europe, these countries in the future, we will all talk about in details because there's so many facts that you would love to know. In Portugal, I have to remind you, they are the very first country in Europe to start drinking tea. Okay, and they are the very first country to start producing tea. If you think tea only produced in Asia, then no. You know, everyone in the world has been taking interest in growing tea. So Portugal is the first country to have tea plantation in Europe. Netherlands is the first country that import tea from China. So their East India company actually brought tea to Germany and then to UK. Before, you think UK has a lot of shipping industry, but they actually rely on getting teas from Netherlands, from Holland. And we are going to skip UK because we all have a big lessons, a big class with UK's etiquette, fourth lesson. Now for Ireland, and Ireland has very similar drinking etiquettes and customs with the UK. So I'm gonna save that for later, for the fourth class. Let's talk about France. You think French like to drink tea? Or they're just a coffee drinker? They actually drink tea. But back then, they start drinking tea very early, earlier than British. But back then they used it as a medicine. And the Louis the 16th drank the tea and said, wait a minute, my headache is gone. So tea actually helped the king to cure his headache. Then, so they say, oh, well, this is just medicine. Later, because tea is very expensive from China, it takes a lot of effort to transport to Europe. So people say, well, only rich people or the monarchy can have tea. So basically, if you drink tea, that you're showing off your social status. Okay, so it's not really popular. It's never been popular among the regular people, only until 20th century. Nowadays, the French, you know them, they like to make, they like a strong smell. So the French tea I inquire also have a lot of flowers, and they add a lot of flowers and beautiful, beautiful quality of teas that you can purchase online if you're interested. Now Germany and Russia, we are just gonna go through. Germany is a country drinks coffee, but there's a place called East Frisian that you should check it out, that you will like to know why they drink coffee, and we'll talk about it in the fourth class in a European etiquette. It's very, very interesting. They have special tea etiquette. And for Russia, I'm gonna have my helper bring this one here. Does anyone know what this is? I'm sure you know. This is the samovar. And how you do it is we will put our, pretend that this one is a tea. Okay, here's this is sort of like a kettle. So it's always boiling with hot water. There's no tea inside. You are going to bring very strong tea up here with a teapot. They say the stronger the tea indicates the degree of your hospitality in Russia. So the stronger you brew, that means you're more, you have more hospitality. I don't know about that. What about if we bring oolong tea? If you brew too strong, that wouldn't be too great. Then you dilute it. After you get a little bit of a tea liquor here, then you use your cup, and then you will dilute your tea over here, and it's drinkable. Then you add milk and sugar to it. Thank you. All right, so let's move on. We're going to get to our music section very soon. So be patient with me. Okay, I want to tell you the influence of tea in history. Now I mentioned it was used as a medicine for Chinese and French. And of course, for British, that's a daily drink. You will have to drink a cup of tea in the morning, a cup of tea in the afternoon, a cup of tea at night, a cup of tea after dinner. And for Chinese too, we drink tea after dinner for sure. And drink tea almost accompany every meal. So that's a beverage for everyone. We also talk about the social status. Back 300 years ago in France, in UK, that only the richest can have teas at home. So it's a social status. But then I also talked about earlier, who brought the teas back to Japan? a Buddhist monk. So same thing actually happened to Korea. It's also a Buddhist monk brought the first tea plant back to Korea and start growing tea. So Buddhism plays a very important part in the tea, spread of tea drinking. And as you know, when you talk about Buddhism, you think about meditation, right? And guess what? You're right. Today, we're going to listen to a piece just called Meditation. Let's go on. But however, it has nothing to do with the Buddhism. So it's actually from an opera. Can we go on to the next slide, please? It's actually coming from an opera called Thais. And this opera is not composed by Chinese either. It's by a French composer. And this story, let me tell you a little bit about the story, about the Thais. Thais is a name of a young lady. Okay, then you can see from the PPT, we're not gonna make you go through the whole opera, it's 2 hours. But we are going to introduce a very interesting piece played by the solo violin and orchestra. It's called Meditation. The meditation is basically not because you sit over there and do nothing and think nothing. I think it's when you need to make a decision that you need to think through what is important in your life, what are you supposed to do, can you benefit others, or you only think about yourself. I mean, it's very easy for us to just think about ourselves, isn't it? But when you are able to let go your ego and you can think about others first, it's always bring peace and joy to your heart because you know you make someone happy. So this is also a story about Thais. Thais is actually a beautiful young lady. However, she was immersed in a life that in the modern term, she's a high-class prostitute, that she hang out with rich people. So this story started with one of her friends. Can we go on to the next slide? Thank you. Yeah. I forgot to mention, this story was composed by the French composer. Then this was written actually for an American soprano, to your surprise, right? She was the composer's favorite soprano. So he actually composed this for her to sing in the leading role and was premiered in Paris, Palais Garnier. Can we go on to the next slide, please? These are some photos for you to see. On the very far left, you see that's a Thais with the beautiful fancy dress and hang out with all these people, have parties. But then in the middle, that's the very final scene that she actually, I'll tell you later. And on the right, you see the man over there, that's the one of the most famous tenor called Placido Domingo. And he sang in Thais for the leading actor I'm about to tell you. Okay, let's go on to the next slide. So we are gonna talk about, I need my notes down here. So the story is about, it's a monk, a young monk, whose name is Athanael, that all of a sudden one day that he dreamed that God is sent him a message that he needs to transform his old friend, Thais, that they both are from the same city. But Thais, as I said before, that she did not have the best profession and she's always hanging out to have a silly life. So this young monk has decided that I must transform her and convince her to go to a convent, then become a nun. So Athanael went back to his native city and met with his one of his very good friends, called Nicias. The Nicias was a rich young man, and he proudly acclaimed to Anastasia, saying, "Guess what? I know this young lady, Thais. I am her current new lover." And of course, that this young monk couldn't take it and say, no, 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 I think she needs to go into the convent and become a nun. She shouldn't have this kind of silly life anymore. Of course, his old friend said, no way, we're having fun with her. And she's having fun with us too. So everyone laughed out of this young monk. So he left. But when that night, Narcissus asked Anthony to come back to a feast where Thais was there as well. So they were talking about going to the convent. Of course, Thais said, you're crazy. Why do I want to give up my luxurious life that I don't have to do anything? I just have to hang out with rich young men and I have a great life. I can have anything I have. Well, I'm not going to be so dumb to do these things like this. But of course, you know, this young monk was very patient, although he actually had developed love for her. But then he said, I shouldn't do that. I am a monk. I should do this spiritual cultivation. I should convince this girl to do this too. So they keep talking and keep talking. And of course, that young monk did not really succeed. So he left. Now let's go on to the act two. So after the feast, then they met again. And this young monk said, no, you really need to come with me. And he was trying to tell her how wonderful the life in the convent. And then she should not do this kind of silly life, because in opera, you know, they all say, yes, you're right. So the famous meditation, this piece is happening in act two that we're talking about, when they're talking after the young monk talk the lady through, so say, you should go. And then she said, I will think about it. Because she's really thinking, one day I will lose my beauty. And what else? Then I will not have a life. So she is thinking, she meditates. That's why she wants to know where she should be going for her next stage, next life. Okay, and then so after she thought, she said, okay, I've decided I'm gonna listen to Athanael. So they are going to meet in the desert. But she couldn't let go a few things. And she asked if she could bring with her to the convent. But of course, Athanael, this young monk, could say, no, 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 you should leave everything behind. But she insisted she wants to bring a little figurine that the young rich merchant that she was hanging out with, Narcissus. Narcissus, give me this, I really like it. Of course, this Anthony is very jealous, even though he thinks that he's a monk, that he already spiritually advanced, but he wouldn't let go. So he burned her house to the ground. Of course, then now she has no home to go back. Okay, now, so they start marching it, and then, so they're leading the way to the convent, and eventually, yes, Thais has entered the convent. Of course, the convent is all females, so Athanael had to leave. After he left, he's thinking about her, so he realized that he actually loved her. And he couldn't escape from the attraction that Thais has shown him, that her beauty and her body, that he just couldn't forget. So he rushed back to the convent, wanted to talk to Thais, and wanted to talk to her and want to marry her. But when he got there, he realized that she is in her deathbed. She was very, very sick. And of course, they sang a duet, and then now it's over. She died. And he left the convent with a broken heart. Okay, this cannot be the best example of for people who actually become a nun and become a monk. I wouldn't encourage that. But now before we listen to our music, I want to talk about, sorry about that, I think I skipped the composer. Yeah, the composer, Jules. Let's see, Massenet. I want to say he's a very nice looking young man, but his story is that he was admitted to the music school, the famous music school in Paris called Paris Conservatoire. And of course he entered young, and as all the custom, all the students graduated and they become a professor at the conservatoire. And then he was teaching over there, he composed. But unfortunately, not many people appreciate his music. They just think, his music is all kind of like a popular type of opera. So they're not worth nothing. It's like nowadays we look down at some kind of music and they say, oh, it's not really high class. So his music was not really valued when he was alive. Only until 1950s and 1960s, all of a sudden people start to discover his music, but he died. And the people say, oh, his music's really cool and really nice, and we should rediscover that and listen to it. So now people start to enjoy his music again. And this is one of his operas that has become very popular. Okay, then we'll talk about who plays the violin. The violinist is called Michael Robin. I have to say, he's my favorite violinist. Unfortunately, he died when he was 35. He died very young, but he was so talented. When he started to practice, he started to learn violin when he was 7, not 3. And with the most famous two violin teachers, which is Joshua Heifetz and Guam Yin, they both think he just unbelievable genius. So when he entered to study with them at age 7, by the age of 13, he was already a soloist with the New York Philharmonic. And age 18, he even toured worldly, and he played with the London Philharmonic as a soloist. But this wouldn't surprise us that his parents are both musicians. His mother was a pianist, and his father was actually a musician at the New York Philharmonic. So we shouldn't be surprised. And why he died so young, we don't know. When one day, when he was performing in Carnegie Hall, all of a sudden he lost his balance and he fell off stage. And then we think it is some kind of neurology problems. So he has a condition. So since then, he was unable to perform. And then what caused his death is in his own apartment. One day he just fell and then just lost consciousness and never awake again. What a shame for a genius. However, today we're very lucky. We are able to preserve one of his recordings, and now we are going to enjoy the music. Well, don't forget, have a sip of tea. So now let's enjoy the meditation from Thais in Act 2, between Scene 1 and Scene 2. Thank you. You all have a very nice and quiet meditating moment. And I hope you have enjoyed your tea. Now, we have a couple minutes left. I am going to answer a couple questions that some of you ask. Oh, I lost it. Anyway, I talk about the Japanese and Korean ceremonies. Yes, we could talk about the Chinese the tea ceremony, but it's a very long and very detailed ceremony. So I would definitely open another class, detailedly just address the Chinese tea ceremony. And also next week, I just want to let you know that we are going to use a Kung Fu style brewing. The difference is, I forgot if I mentioned the Western style that use less tea leaves. Oh yes, I did, but use more water. This way we brew a very tender type of a tea. But Kung Fu style requires a skill. What does Kung Fu mean? It means excellence in connoisseurship, that you have to be good at your skill. So you want to be very careful. You use a lot more of tea leaves. You use less liquid water to brew your tea. So we have to skillfully extract the tea out of the teapot and tea leaves. So next week, we will experience the Kung Fu style. We can use any kind of tea to do Kung Fu style. Remember, we have used more tea leaves and less water. We will talk about that next week while we brew. And the other question is, if you have not received our tea tasting journal, I will make sure that I send you again tonight or tomorrow. And my apology if you have not got that yet. And any other questions? I did not cover something. May I have the questions again? Yes, between 4 and 5, you're welcome to join us at any time if you have problem with your disconnection. Okay, they're definitely okay. How can we get the tea journal? We'll send it to you. And how hot is the water? It depends on the tea. Since we are brewing oolong tea, normally it would be 95 Celsius, around 195 to 105 Fahrenheit, that kind of water. If you're not sure, if you don't have a thermometer to test the water, you could just boil the water. Remember, always boil your water. Boil the water and let it sit for about 30 seconds to 1 minute, and then it will cool down a little bit, and that would be much better for your oolong tea. Oolong tea, it does like a little bit hotter bath, water bath, is because most of them are being rolled many, many times, and it become a shape of like a little ball. So it's very tightly, all the leaves are very tightly curled together. You want to use a hot water to open it. So you don't want to use really cold water like when you brew your green tea. Let's see. Yes, the temperature. Let me see. I think I have I answered all your questions? If I have, then I hope you have enjoyed this session. And don't forget to come back next week at 4 o'clock. Our time is from 4 to 5, but you will be admitted into our chat room and our Zoom meeting at about 3:55. So do wait for us. And when we are ready, we will let you in. Then we'll enjoy again. So next week, we will come back here and see everybody. So, okay, I'm going to say goodbye now. If you like the music, go back and listen again. You can find it easily on YouTube from other performers as well. They are also fantastic performers for you to enjoy. But don't forget about Michael Robin, even though he is long gone, but his music always stay with us. Well, have fun for this week. I'll see you next Saturday. Bye, everybody. Bye. I'm Thank you, everybody, for your behind-the-scenes work.